once you became a duchess, one of the most important things, of course, was the coronation of our present queen.
Oh, yes, it was absolutely wonderful.
I think you had some trouble with your robes for the coronation.
Well, I didn't have any actual trouble, but I just hadn't any. Because, you see, the actual previous robes were worn by Princess Louise, who was a Duchess of Argyll, who was also daughter of Queen Victoria, therefore royal, and she wore purple robes, which I could not wear.
A commoner cannot wear purple.
No, a commoner cannot wear purple. They were crimson red. Therefore, I had to go out and get... I mean, I had to order robes of my own, which was rather rare. But they were new, and they were fresh, which I could not say of all the peeresses. And everything was new. The dress was new, the robes were new.
And your coronet?
And the coronet I had to again borrow, you see, from Claire, Duchess of Sutherland, because she had two coronets, and I had none. So it was a question of borrowing.
Something I wouldn't have mentioned to you, unless you had devoted so much time and space to it in your book, is the divorce from the Duke of Argyll.
Yes.
Will you talk about that? You say you were completely innocent, that you were the innocent party, and
yet
the Scottish judge found you the guilty party.
Yes. And I say all of these allegations were completely false, and I denied them on oath for about a week, I think, or more, which is really quite an ordeal. And I will always deny them.
You do say in the book that you were not the guilty party, that you were, in fact, innocent. Does this then show that there can be something wrong with the Scottish legal system?
Well, I can't say that. I've been actually told since the divorce that I hadn't got a hope in Scotland because I was, you see, a woman fighting alone, and that it is a completely man's country. I think any judge has got, in a way, the right, you know, to make up his own opinion as to who he believes. But I believe he went overboard in his duties as a judge. He was extremely criticised for it.
Well, the way he castigated your character...
Yes, that was completely unnecessary. And he was criticised for that. And very, very, very much. And he actually apologised for it afterwards, you know, to the press.
Still lingering upon the divorce case, I've looked back over the press clippings of that time, I read your book. One feels that there could have been a conspiracy?
Well, I think, you know, for legal reasons, I cannot answer that question.
I understand. There was one flash of humor when you were talking about the divorce, when you said that if all the lovers you were supposed to have had, if that had been true, you should have been in the Guinness Book of Records.
That's right. It was almost impossible. There wouldn't have been time.
You see, the lurid rumors and the scandal that grew up around that case, that grew up around the court, still lives with many people of over 30 today, doesn't it?
I know that. And I think the only unfair thing about the press is, and I'm honestly, you know, not anti-press at all. I think the press have been, in a way, very helpful to me very often. And I've often, as I say, thanked them for the help they've given me over various projects and causes. But over this, I think they are absolutely, in a way, bewitched. They cannot forget it. It's 12 years ago, 13, 14, 15, it was actually 5 years, you know, fighting. But you'd think, you know, by now they'd be getting tired of it, and also the public would be getting tired of it. But on and on they go. If I go to Hong Kong, if I go to Bangkok, I can see them rustling through the files and thinking, you know, divorce, we'll bring that up again. And it's getting so boring and extremely tiresome. You know, there's an awful lot happened since then.
One of your descriptions of yourself at the end of the book is you say, I'm still that dumb bunny.
Yeah.
Tell us what that dumb bunny is.
Well, it was a little sort of china rabbit. which I gave my husband.
Which husband?
As a present, Ian Argyll. And I said, here's a picture of me. And it's a rather dumb looking bunny. I believe you have it here somewhere, haven't you? And it was a sort of a joke between us. And it was always on his desk, always. I said, here's me, the idiot figure. And the thing had a crocus in its mouth, you know, and it looked awfully silly. And after he left, I mean, at the awful day when he really packed up and left, when I felt extremely unhappy, the only thing he left was the dumb bunny.
Which was your gift
because
to him.
I'd given it to him. And that was the thing that actually hurt most of all. And I think he really meant it to hurt me.
So when you handle little dumb bunny today, it's...
I'm always going to keep dumb bunny. But believe me, I don't, lie awake nights thinking about it anymore. I mean, your life goes on. I've had a very busy life since then. And it was a very unpleasant, unhappy, and a very heartbreaking chapter of my life.
In the last 15 years or so, you've had a very interesting life. You traveled a great deal. Can you tell us where you've been?
Well, I could almost really tell you easier where I haven't been.
Yes.
You know, I've been all over the world, and I've met a great many very, interesting people. And you see, to me, travel is almost like a tonic. You give me an air ticket and I'm off, and I feel quite different.
It's not an escape.
No, it's not an escape at all. It's a tonic. I want to travel right this minute, and I've got nothing to actually escape from. If you give me an air ticket tonight, I'd be probably off tomorrow.
Stay with us for a few more minutes, please.
I promise I will. I've got too much to do at the moment. But I've got a great sort of, in a way, curiosity to see the world.
I noticed when I went to your downstairs lavatory that you had 14 dog leads hanging there. You are a great animal lover, aren't you?
Absolutely love them. And I'm afraid the dog leads, one is dead of those leads. And so they've been passed on to now the son and the grandson, Alphonse and Antoine. And I adore all animals of any kind or shape or form.
Do you think that you love animals because they don't realize that you're rich, beautiful, and powerful? You're just their mum.
Oh, no, I've loved animals since I was a child. Since I was a little girl, I've loved animals. All my life.
People often say that people who love animals don't love people.
I love people. I don't think you have to actually choose between them. I love people.
Duchess, thank you.
Not at all. Thank you, Elaine, for all your kindness and patience with me.